Wow, I've never heard of the term coconut left atrium before. It sounds like something you'd want to have.
Coconut left atrium is a term used when a large part of or the entire left atrial wall becomes calcified, such as this one. It's sometimes also referred to as a porcelain left atrium, but coconut sounds much better. Although rare, it has been most commonly reported in association with rheumatic heart disease, especially after mitral valve replacement. Rarely has it been associated with other causes, such as thoracic radiation or end-stage renal disease. While it can be an incidental finding on imaging, it's important to be aware of it before cardiac surgery, as suturing heavily calcific atrial walls can be quite difficult. More recently, it has been associated with a really interesting clinical syndrome.
What is it?
To tell you about it, let's review a case from the CardioNerds Case Reports series. A woman in her mid-60s with a history of rheumatic mitral stenosis, status post-mechanical mitral valve replacement, HFpEF and paroxysmal atrial fibrillation status post-ablation, presents with subacute worsening dyspnea despite escalating diuretic doses. TTE shows an ejection fraction of 62%, normal gradients across the mitral valve without mitral regurgitation, and a dilated IVC. She's admitted with a presumed diagnosis of decompensated heart failure. IV diuretics, however, did not help with her symptoms. So the next step was to take the patient to the table of truth.
You can't handle the truth!
She underwent a right heart cath, and this is her pulmonary capillary wedge pressure tracing. What we're seeing here are giant V waves. To explain these waves, let's quickly review the basics of a right heart cath. For a right heart cath, we use a Swan-Ganz catheter, which has a balloon near its end and a port that opens at the tip of the catheter distal to the balloon. This port is connected to a pressure transducer. During the procedure, the catheter is inserted into the right atrium and the balloon is inflated. The catheter then follows the direction of blood towards the pulmonary arteries, with pressure tracing being recorded at the right atrium, right ventricle, and pulmonary arteries. The catheter is then advanced further to one of the branches of the pulmonary artery with the balloon inflated until it is wedged, essentially cutting off flow proximal to the balloon, and the catheter can only sense pressure distal to the balloon. When this occurs, the pressure in the distal port rapidly falls and after several seconds reaches a stable lower value. This is the wedge pressure, and it approximates pulmonary venous pressure, which in turn approximates the left atrial pressures in the absence of pulmonary vein stenosis. And in the absence of mitral stenosis, the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure can also reflect left ventricular diastolic pressure. So what do these waveforms mean? We have an A wave, which reflects a rise in atrial pressure during atrial systole, and a V wave, which reflects the left atrial filling against a closed mitral valve. Back to our patient's waveforms. She had giant V waves, indicating a massive increase in left atrial pressure during atrial diastole. This coincides with ventricular systole with rising LV pressures. Thus, giant V waves most likely point towards a communication between the left atrium and the left ventricle during ventricular systole, and that's why they are classically seen in mitral regurgitation. Based on the right heart cath, our patient most likely had MR that was not picked up on TTE. So the next step was to get a transesophageal echo. However, it also did not reveal any MR.
What?
So how do we explain the giant V waves now? We know that compliance equals the change in volume divided by the change in pressure. We also just knew that V waves reflect an increase in atrial pressure during atrial filling. So if we rearrange this equation and apply it to the left atrium, we realize that elevated interatrial pressure and giant V waves can be caused by either increased volume or decreased compliance. Excess volume can be caused by either increased filling of the left atrium, with mitral regurgitation being the most common cause, or decreased emptying of blood out of the atrium, such as AFib or mitral stenosis. Since causes of increased volume have been excluded in our case, therefore our patient must have a reduced left atrial compliance. Inside this stiff, non-compliant left atrium, the small changes in volume that happen normally during atrial filling can lead to massive elevation in pressure and giant V waves.
It's an interesting point.
Our patient also underwent a chest CT to exclude pulmonary vein stenosis as a cause of her dyspnea after AFib ablation. It revealed normal pulmonary veins, as well as a heavily calcific or a coconut left atrium. So let's summarize our patient's data. She has a history of mitral valve replacement and AFib ablation, presents with heart failure symptoms, mainly dyspnea. She has a well-functioning mechanical mitral valve with normal gradients, giant V-waves on the right heart calf despite the absence of mitral regurgitation on both TTE and TEE, no pulmonary vein stenosis on a chest CT, which also showed a coconut left atrium. All this allowed us to make the diagnosis of... Stiff left atrium is a syndrome of dyspnea and pulmonary hypertension secondary to loss of atrial compliance or atrial diastolic dysfunction. It was first described in 1988 in a female patient years after mitral valve replacement. In 2011, it was first described in patients undergoing AFib ablation. In that study, new or worsening pulmonary hypertension with associated left atrial diastolic abnormalities was detected in 1.4% of the patients after ablation. We will most likely see more patients with stiff left atrial syndrome with the increasing number of AFib ablations being done each year. In fact, the literature on stiff left atrial syndrome following AFib ablation has been growing since then. A diagnostic algorithm has also been recently published, incorporating the diagnostic criteria we use with our case. Heart failure symptoms after AFib ablation, giant V waves in the absence of MR, and no pulmonary vein stenosis.
Tell me what to do.
While diuresis is the mainstay of management at this time,
I gotta go pee.
There have been case reports of atrial septostomy to relieve the elevated pressures in the left atrium. And the most important aspect of management is that we need to treat the cause of decompensation. For more information on the cause of decompensation in our case, please tune in to episode 73 of the CardioNerds Case Reports series, beautifully presented by Scripps Cardiology Fellows Christine Chen and Andrew Chang. Thank you for watching, but now my question for you is...
We happy?
Brother bought a coconut, he bought it for the dime. His sister had another one, she paid it for the lime. She put the lime in the coconut, she drank and poured up. She put the lime in the coconut, she drank and poured up. She put the lime in the coconut, she drank and poured up. She put the lime in the coconut, she called the doctor, woke him up and said, doctor.